I'm Lloyd Holiday, and this is the Cost of a Thing podcast. Thanks for listening in today. So what happened to that great standard of living that we had here in the United States in the 1960s and 70s? Well, that's what the Cost of a Thing podcast is all about, and that's what I'm going to be talking about here. Anything that affects our standard of living. Okay, the topic of my podcast today is how the toilet paper shortage is very much like the housing shortage. And I'm going to explain how that is. Okay, we have this big toilet paper shortage, and it's kind of comical in a way, unless you don't have any toilet paper. It's caused by hype and the hysteria. And of course, it's surrounding this coronavirus thing. People thought they weren't going to be able to get any paper product. So they went into the stores and they just hoarded as much as they could get, and now they bought it all up. There's none left in the stores, and they're trying to make more, and eventually the hoarders will have so much toilet paper that they won't be able to buy any more or store any more unless they get a storage unit or something like that. it's insane what they're doing. But see, and what the strange thing is if everybody just stayed calm and bought the normal amount of toilet paper like you always did, there'd be plenty of toilet paper for everybody out there. But that's not what they do. It's the, I'm going to get mine now. I'm going to have it. Then I feel secure that I'm going to be able to have that toilet paper when I need it. They worried that everybody else was going to do that, and so they better get theirs. And hysteria like that is a very human emotion. What you're seeing is human emotion right out there in front of your face. When you look at that aisle and there's nothing in that toilet paper aisle in Walmart or wherever you go shop, grocery store, you're seeing human hysteria at its finest. This is what human beings do. So how does that tie into housing in the current? There's kind of a housing shortage around the country. Otherwise, the prices of houses would not be so high as they are right now. Not in all areas, but in many areas, most areas, coastal, west coast, northeast, and many areas even in the interior now, house prices cost 5-10 times. That's the average house, 5-10 times the annual average income in that area. And maybe even more. Some areas could be, in San Francisco and areas like that could be 15 times. 20 times average annual income for that average house. And historically, the price of an average house in almost all areas was about 2.5-3 times average annual income for that average house. And that went along that way for hundreds of years. I tracked it all the way back to George Washington's time. The average house cost about 2-3 times average annual income. So what's driving those prices to 5 times, 10 times, 15, 20 times the average income in that area? It's hysteria. It's hysteria. One of the things is hysteria, like the toilet paper hysteria. They saw all these people moving in all the time, and they see the trend. They see the restrictions. There's restrictions on housing in some of these areas. You can't build just what you want. There's not even enough land in some of the areas to build more houses or condos or apartments. And rents are equally as high in these areas too. Many times more than they used to be. You know, the average rent of an average apartment or house in an area would be about a quarter of a person's income. For that was their total housing cost, with electrical, water, was about a quarter of your income. Now that's not the case in a lot of these areas. It can be 50% of your income. And so this is what is going on out there in many areas. Not all areas, but there's still some reasonably priced areas out there. And if you want to see more about this and how the housing prices have been inflated to those bubble and hyper amounts, I did a podcast. It's one of my top 10 super ripoffs from our standard of living in the last 40 or 50 years is house prices and rents. And I did part 1 and 2 on that, and there's the links up on the screen, as you can see, to those if you want to look at that. I get quite a bit more detail on what caused these housing prices to go up and the rents to go up over the last 50 years. So the toilet paper hysteria is caused by that human instinct, emotion, maybe a little greed in there, a little hysteria, panic comes in. One of the main reasons housing and rents are high is that it's that same human emotion in there, greed, hysteria, panic, that you're not going to be able to get yours. So what they do is, I'm going to get my house, and I'll pay a little bit more. I'll pay more to get it before you will. It's like a panic mentality. You see it at like the Black Friday sales. When these people go in there and they're slugging it out for these Black Friday deals at Walmart or some of the other stores. And it's the same kind of thing. Any item, anything you can buy or a product that is perceived that there's a shortage of it, there's going to be some of this hysteria, panic buying that goes on. That's how the toilet paper shortage and hysteria is a lot like the housing shortage and hysteria and the prices, the high prices of housing. We haven't seen toilet paper go up in price, or at least I haven't, because there's not even any there to get. So I don't think they've raised the prices, or they may be not even allowing them to raise the prices because it's kind of a necessary item. But housing is allowed to go up in price, see? And, you know, it's a necessary item. It's more necessary than toilet paper to have a house or a place to live, to rent a place. It is the same human emotions driving it. And another observation that I've made over the years, is that there are some people who enjoy or get a thrill out of keeping something other people need or want. I don't know if it's a little mental problem or a little evil or just some kind of meanness. I don't know. But I've seen that behavior, and maybe I think all of us, if we think about it, have probably seen it. They want to tie up what they perceive other people need or want. And then, I don't know, that gives them some kind of a power or some kind of a thrill. And I don't really understand the psychology of it completely. But they're out there. If there's a perceived shortage of something, these people will be there like buzzards. And there may be a little of that going on in this toilet paper thing. And there could be some of it, of course, going on in the housing market too. They tie up those houses, or so others can't get them, or that then they have to pay them a large amount of money to either rent them or buy them. They're out there. Now, you know, I can remember when I lived in the Los Angeles area, there would be, and this was back 30 years ago. 30 plus years ago that I lived there, there'd be a new housing development come up in Orange County or out in the Riverside area or so forth. I remember seeing on TV, people would line up at the sales office before it ever came on sale. They'd get word, hey, we're going to start selling this, you know, next Saturday. And they'd line up and they'd stay in tents. There'd be hundreds of people lined up to get the opportunity to buy one of these houses. That's how short the houses were and how big the hype was. They'd be living out there in tents for days, lined up so they could get a crack at one of these new houses in that housing tract that was being developed. And the only way to break the psychology and the hysteria, the panic of these types of shortages, perceived shortages, and created shortages, any shortage, the only way to break the psychology of that is by having a huge supply that is so big that the hysterical people can't absorb it all. They can't buy it. There's just too many. And then they get the idea that there's going to be a lot, and the hysteria then breaks. So to break this toilet paper hysteria, they'd have to just produce so much toilet paper that, like I said before, these guys can't even, these hoarders can't hoard it all. They can't buy it all. They just don't have enough money or enough space to keep it all. And they just realize, geez, I got so much now that I'll never run out. And there's so much more in the stores. And then the the thing's over at that point. And the same goes for housing. The only way that you can break these hyper prices, these bubble prices in these areas, is to have so much supply that the investors and speculators realize they can't buy them all up. And there's just so many of them that the price goes down instead of up. That's what happened around 2008 to 2011. They realized the price wasn't going to go up anymore, so that it wasn't a good financial decision to buy a house when the price is going down. So the psychology broke, and there was so many houses on the market, the realtors and the other speculators just couldn't buy them all up. The bankers, nobody was buying. So there was this huge glut, and the prices went way down, and the psychology was broken. You might say they broke the back of the speculator and the investor, and they got out of the market. They wanted to sell because the price was going down. And hey, there was a lot of good bargains, a lot of good deals out there. A lot of people got houses during that time for even less than the cost to build a house. So that huge supply, more than the hoarders or the speculators or whoever it is that's buying this stuff, more than they can absorb, that ends it. That ends the psychology. Of course, that'll happen with this toilet paper as soon as this coronavirus thing is over with. And people realize there's plenty of toilet paper in the stores. You know, there'll be plenty of toilet paper again at great prices like it used to be. And the same things with housing. If the supply went way up and or the demand came down for some reason, like it did in 2008, 9, 10, and 11, prices come down, it breaks the bubble. The bubble then breaks and it's over. And we've seen the same hysteria with many things. Gasoline is one that you see probably every year. There's a period where, you know, there's this perceived shortage. There might be a hurricane in the Gulf of Mexico or a war over in Iran or something going on in the Middle East with the terrorists or something. And there's a perception gas is going to go up. So the speculators come in and they buy up the gas futures and it drives the prices up to, you know, $60, $80, $100 or more per barrel, and then we have to pay more at the pump because of that. It's the same hype involved really in anything that there's a perceived shortage of. And like I say, if you want to hear more about the reasons why there's a shortage of housing and why the demand is so high for housing in those areas, look at my housing super ripoff podcasts. And of course, the reason why I'm talking about this is because housing prices are one of the main things that might be the centerpiece of your standard of living. What you have to pay, percentage you have to pay of your income to buy a house or to pay rent, is a big determiner of your standard of living. If your house prices are too high and your rent's too high, you don't have any more money to spend on things you want, and you don't have any money to save, so you can't get ahead. And that's why high housing costs, including rents and the price to purchase, is so destructive to our standard of living. Thank you for listening in today. And until next time, this is Lloyd Holiday signing off.